The name of this video is Self-Inductance Neumann. That is, we are going to understand if we can use Neumann integrals to find the self-inductance of a circuit, whereas typically I told you the Neumann integrals are useful for mutual inductance. Quite interestingly, some people were still in 2013 making some research about this, whether it's useful or not. Of course, it's possible to use Neumann integrals to find self-inductances, and in fact, Maxwell, 200 years ago or so, was already able to do so. And so that's, we are going to follow the path of Maxwell to find the inductance of a simple loop. It seems like a simple structure, a loop. Actually, it's very complicated to find, to actually prove it. And it involves lots of tricks of physics, which I really think are beautiful. All right. So let's consider in this video, before going into that, a sort of preamble to that concept of the self-inductance of a loop, which is called Maxwell inductance. So can we find the self-inductance for a Neumann integrals? Well, let's consider naively a circuit as such. This one is just the central axis, the longitudinal axis of a circuit gamma, let's call it, okay? So as always, if I pick a point somewhere here, and this point, there will be a tangent unit vector t right there. And there will be source points. So this can be a source point, but actually this can also be an observation point if I only have one single circuit and I'm attempting to compute the self-inductance of this object, okay? Because it's the inductance on its own. Okay, so if that is the case, let's break down the Neumann integral associated with this. Well, the Neumann integral for the self-inductance in this naive approach would just be mu naught divided by 4 pi, the double nested circulations on gamma, and again on gamma of t dot t divided by, let's just call it r, which is the distance between two points. For example, r could be this distance here if q and p are not the same. Okay, dl times dl. Now, in this case, unfortunately, there exists an infinite set of cases when q happens to be equal to p, okay? So, which means, if you really want to be precise here, we should have written down here qp. This simply means that the integrand, this rqp, which is in the denominator of the integrand, in an infinite set of instances, becomes just that, which is equal to zero, which means this integral becomes ill-defined because the integrand diverges to infinity. That seems to be quite a big problem to use Neumann integrals to find the self-inductance, isn't it? Well, maybe we can find a solution to this problem. And in fact, people did. The basic idea, the concept behind what we're about to do in the next series of few videos is to actually now consider the actual conductor. And for simplicity, let's give a cross-sectional area delta A, okay? So it's a small wire, okay? So this small wire, let's show it here. This is our small wire. And let's give it a nice thickness to it. And now let's sketch. So for example, this is a cross-sectional area here. And this cross-sectional area, let's call it delta A, small compared, the square root is small compared to the length of this wire. So it's quasi-filiform, let's say. So now, in this quasi-filiform construction wire, let's define two axis, not only one longitudinal, but two axes. This green axis, which I call just gamma, and this orange axis, which I call gamma prime. I choose these two. I can choose as many as I want in such a way, this is gamma prime, that they never touch each other. That is, there is a small distance, delta, between them. And in particular, what I'm interested in, it's the mean value of this distance here. The mean value of this distance, delta L. Okay? So these two axes never touch each other, and yet they are within the small cross-sectional area of the overall conductor. Okay? So this mean of delta L is always different than zero. For each point P or P prime on gamma and gamma prime, respectively. Okay, this is the essence of this whole problem. Because now, by means of this trick, even though we still are considering a single wire, we consider two longitudinal two axes associated with it, which are always a little bit different than each other. And this, I can almost always do it if I have a cross-section area delta A, okay? Of course, if it's identically filiform by definition, then you can't. There is only one gamma. But if there is a little thickness to it, which you can almost, in real life, actually there is always, then it makes total sense to redefine a new Naumann integral where we have mu naught divided by 4 pi, the nested circulation, the first one is on gamma, and the second one is on gamma prime, or vice versa, the same, of t dot t prime, which are the tangent unit vectors for the, this one would be t, and this one would be t prime. For example, here, this would be t prime for gamma and gamma prime respectively, divided by r, p and p prime. You can also call them qq prime if you want, okay? Because actually for sources, it's better to call it qq prime, same thing, dl, dl prime. This denominator here, in this case, well, in this case, this denominator is always different than zero because we have always a little distance here between these two gamma and gamma prime lines. So this is, in other words, this gamma and gamma prime, because of this condition here, gamma is basically different than gamma prime, okay? So that's what this tells us for each point, for each pair of points. Okay, so if that is the case, if now we take the limit for the mean value of delta L that goes to 0 plus of this quantity here, if this limit exists and is finite, that this converges, we call it the self-inductance of this circuit. Okay? And in fact, typically what this gives us is the Cauchy principal value, PB. Okay? And this gives the self-inductance. So you need to make a limit sort of, you need to intend to write these Neumann integrals with this caveat of having a little distance between these two lines in the case of self-inductance, and go then in the limit that goes to zero. If the integral converges, then you have a self-inductance. In other words, if I have a structure like a loop like this, to find the self-inductance, I need to consider two loops and then in the limit make them coincide. In other words, I'm calculating the mutual inductance between, effectively this is the mutual inductance between two distinguished loops, and then in the limit it becomes one loop, and therefore you get the self-inductance. So that's the essence of the Maxwell inductance we're about to study in the next series of videos. And so with this in mind, exactly what we're going to do next is try to use this concept of going from the mutual inductance in the limit, reduce the mutual to a single circuit, and therefore the mutual becomes the self-inductance of the circuit. That's it.